Several items I want to tell you about before we get underway. Number one, our dear co-host, Christy, is going to be with us in a red dress, but yeah. I'm thinking about Terry.
For Terry, yeah.
Terry's father had a fall, suffered a blow to his head. Mm-hmm. He was 88, I think it was, and he's had intracranial bleeding, and he passed away.
Did he?
Yeah.
I didn't know he passed away.
So pray for Terry. Oh. I talked to her yesterday, and she said, I just want to pray that he'll go to be with the Lord. So anyhow, that's something to talk about. Greece, the Greek situation is getting bad. There's a run on the Greek banks. They've pulled about $900 million out of the Greek banks, the investors have. And they're talking about chaos if Greek leaves the eurozone. So we don't. That's something looming ahead of us. And the other thing is, it looks like gold is into a bear market. It's come down, it's crowded $1,500 an ounce, but that's a whole lot higher than 500 or 600 like it used to be. So that's just something you can keep in mind. But Goldman Sachs says gold is going to go back up again. So I think just hold steady. But nevertheless, I just pass those little things on to you.
It's a lot. I tell you what. Well, were we going to talk about Iran a little bit?
Yes, we are.
All right. Well, let's talk about Iran. It's been 10 years since 9/11, and terrorists have New York City in their crosshairs once again. This time, the threat isn't coming from Al-Qaeda. The next terrorist attack actually could come from Iran. And as Eric Stuckelback reports, the Islamic regime may be putting the pieces in place to strike.
The 1993 World Trade Center bombing, 9/11, and more recently, the Times Square bomber. Over the past two decades, terrorists have repeatedly targeted New York City. Now the world's largest state sponsor of terror is reportedly taking aim. A recent warning came from Capitol Hill about the threat posed by Iran and its proxy, the terror group Hezbollah.
We know Hezbollah operatives are here. The question is whether these Hezbollah operatives have the capacity to carry out attacks in the homeland and how quickly they can become fully operational.
New York Congressman Peter King said that hundreds of operatives are here and that some Iranian diplomats stationed at the UN are much more than they appear.
Several of their comrades of these UN mission types in New York were removed from the UN mission and sent back to Iran after the NYPD caught them photographing the city's rail systems in the years since 9/11.
And according to one NYPD official, there have been at least five other instances of what he called hostile reconnaissance.
They see that attacking New York or threatening the facilities in New York destabilized the financial market and automatically hurt the U.S. economy.
Former CIA double agent Reza Khalili was once a member of Iran's Revolutionary Guards Corps. His book, A Time to Betray, lays out Iran's potential plots against America.
Many cells are present here. Now they have their eyes on our power plants, water supply, food distribution, bridges, tunnels, anything that could create fear and also disrupt the daily life of Americans.
One Iranian naval commander said recently that Iran's forces can move within 3 miles of New York City if they so choose. Khalili says an attack against Iran's nuclear facilities could be the trigger.
They believe an attack on Syria or Iran would be sufficient to trigger the response, which would be terrorist attacks on the world stage against Israel and U.S. interests, attack on Israel, and attack on U.S. soil.
Iran shocked many analysts with its plot last year to attack foreign diplomats in Washington, D.C. A nuclear-armed Iranian regime would likely become even bolder.
You can tell that Iran gets more aggressive the closer they get towards a nuclear weapon. Rather than with international pressure making them restrain themselves, it's actually making them act more and more aggressively.
Iran and Hezbollah also have an extensive network in Latin America, which they can use to strike at the United States. And according to Khalili, Iranian agents also have a presence in some U.S. mosques. Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News, Washington.
Well, terror is just that. The idea is to make people afraid. And so they blow up one train, one airplane, one power plant, someplace, lob a missile out of an offshore ship, It would just take one, and all of a sudden we clamped down. After 9/11, it cost $50,000. Al-Qaeda used borrowed airplanes. They didn't own them. They borrowed them and then ran them into buildings. And as a result of that, we spent about $600 million in defense. Because, I mean, they're smart. They know what they can do. And so they're going to keep testing us. And sooner or later, we might decide we've had enough of this pipsqueak nation, and we just might decide to crush them. I don't know when that's going to happen, but it'll have to do with oil, what happens to the oil supply of the world, and will the Iranians start a new currency that'll threaten the dollar? I mean, you watch that on the world stage, and we'll see what happens. Well, you can always get the latest on terror threats by checking out Stackelbeck on Terror. That's Eric's blog and weekly program on CBNNews.com. Well, Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories from the CBN Newsroom. Lee?
Pat, House Speaker John Boehner says Republicans will once again play hardball when it's time to vote on a debt ceiling increase. Boehner says he will call for cuts greater than the amount of the increase. Republicans took that same stance during last summer's debt ceiling fight. Democrats claim it brought the U.S. close to defaulting on its loans. During a speech in Iowa Tuesday, Republican presidential candidate Mitt Romney said Obama is feeding the spending fire.
We will stop borrowing unfathomable sums of money we can't even imagine from foreign countries we're never even going to visit. I will work with you to make sure we put out this spending and borrowing fire.
An Obama spokeswoman says the president has put out a plan to reduce the debt. The national debt is now at $15.7 trillion. Pat, back to you.
Well, this gridlock in Washington, the president is not giving up on anything. He was willing to shut the government down rather than to take away funding for Planned Parenthood. They'll waste money on everything. It doesn't matter. And their sacred cows are out there, sacred cows to the left, and he's going to protect them at all costs. And then he'll talk about a war against the poor. It's not a war against the poor. It's people trying to stop wasting money so that we'll have some future for our children. But I don't think the Republicans should get involved in this debt ceiling thing. They don't win. People don't understand it, and it's not a good thing. Pick your fight carefully. If we want to fight, let's fight about something more important. But fighting on the debt ceiling, you've got to, you know, there's no doubt about it. They have to raise the debt ceiling. They have to do it, or we'll go in default. We can't default on our obligations. So it's got to be done. So if you know you have to do something, go ahead and do it, and then have your fight in an area that the public might understand and appreciate. Lee?
Pat, the debt problem in Greece is so bad that some are predicting it could lead to a civil war in that country with a global impact. An issue is whether Greece will stay in the Eurozone or go it alone. Dale Hurd has that story.
If Greece were to drop the euro and go back to its old currency, the drachma, some analysts fear the worst. The value of the new Greek currency would immediately plunge and could collapse, making the Greeks destitute. Supplies of oil and gas, food, and even medicine could run out. The wealthy would flee, along with their money and their businesses. Support for radical political parties would likely surge. A Greek government minister has warned that what will prevail are armed gangs with Kalashnikovs, and which one has the greatest number of Kalashnikovs will count. We will end up in civil war. Some Greeks sense what might be coming.
Nothing changes. Only with a revolution can things change.
If this political system doesn't change with new leaders, Greece will not move forward. We are living moments from the apocalypse.
After Greece left, the euro debt crisis would then spread even faster to the other sick Eurozone countries, which is why, to Eurogroup President Jean-Claude Juncker, a Greek exit is unthinkable.
I don't envisage, not even for one second, Greece leaving the euro area. This is nonsense. This is propaganda.
But the Greeks are tired of being told by Brussels how to run their own nation.
Brussels is not Moscow, but some have compared the two. Czech President Václav Klaus said the European Union reminded him of the old Soviet Union, because Europeans have so little say in their own governance.
The dictates from Brussels in Germany have many Greeks in an angry, rebellious mood and willing to risk the unthinkable, a debt default and a Eurozone exit. What would happen next could be ugly.
If we were heading towards a bankruptcy, then social cohesion, there's no question that would be completely destroyed.
It's why many Greek leaders are working hard to try to keep their nation in the Eurozone. Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Pat, in your opinion, are the experts engaging in hyperbole here, or is the situation truly chaotic there?
Well, it's not ever as chaotic. The Greeks are good people, and they can get it together if they want to. You know, they're like a lot of tempestuous children. They want their little goodies, and if they take the goodies away, then they're going to revolt and have a war. Well, that's nonsense. But at the same time, they talked about a capital flight. As I mentioned, they've already pulled $900 million, almost $1 billion, out of Greek banks in the last few days. The rich are already moving. They're voting with their feet and getting out. If the politicians can't get together, you just wonder, why can't you get together? You know, if people live in harmony, there's nothing impossible. If people live in harmony, but if there's division, Jesus said, a house divided against itself can't stand. The Greeks are divided against themselves, and they can't stand. And Europe's the same way. If it's divided against itself, it can't stand. And if Germany is a rock of fiscal stability, and the French and the Spaniards are profligate, I mean, what's going to happen? You can't keep them together. The house will fall apart. Lee?
China is finally letting political activist Chen Guangcheng apply for a passport. 2 weeks ago, Chinese officials said Chen could come to America to study, but he and his family have been stuck in a hospital room all this time, and Chinese officials had done nothing until the U.S. House of Representatives held another hearing Tuesday. Legislators heard stark testimony from a Chinese woman forced to undergo 5 abortions. She told of working in a typical factory where women had to strip once a month to prove they were not pregnant. Co-workers also spied on each other and turned in pregnant women.
2 of my pregnancies were reported by my colleagues to the Family Planning Commission. When discovered, pregnant women would be dragged and to undergo forced abortions. There was no other choice. We had no dignity as potential childbearers.
In China, brothers and sisters are illegal, and women are treated as criminals if they have a child without explicit government permission.
And Chen's opposition to China's one-child policy earned him and his wife many beatings and years of house arrest. That's why he fled in April and took sanctuary in the U.S. embassy, causing a diplomatic crisis. Property battles in the Episcopal Church are costing a prominent D.C. area congregation its multi-million dollar historic home. The 4,000 members of Falls Church Anglican must now find a new place to worship. But the transition is something they consider a privilege.
On Sunday, the members of Falls Church Anglican held the last service in their beloved sanctuary. A Fairfax County judge gave the final order to depart this spring, ending the breakaway congregation's 6-year fight with its former denomination. At stake, this multi-million dollar real estate, which dates back to 1732. Why give it up? Anglicans say the Episcopal Church has drifted from the historic Christian faith.
It's an outcome of our desire to be faithful to the person and the teachings of Christ.
On Tuesday, Rector Yates held a final staff meeting full of memories and hope for the future.
The church is people, it's not buildings. And we knew that, but we didn't know it as well as we thought we knew it.
Church staff are now relocating to temporary quarters, not really sure just where they'll land. But in the midst of such uncertainty, Yates says the faith of his congregation is growing.
What we're feeling is a great sense of privilege to be going through what we're going through. It's sure not easy, but it's a blessing, and we know that we have a lot to learn through it, so we're thankful for it.
Falls Church Episcopal, a congregation of 200, has met off-site since the 2006 split. It's now moving back onto the property and will hold its first service there tonight. Heather Sell, CBN News.
And the returning Episcopalians may want to dust off a copy of their historic statement of faith. The 39 Articles of Religion, as they're known. Article 18 here says, "For Holy Scripture doth set out unto us only the name of Jesus Christ, whereby men must be saved." The problem is that even the bishop of the Episcopal Church does not believe that. She's on record as saying that Jesus is a way, not the way. So, Pat, the question is, who's really left the church?
Ooh, I remember Jimmy Burns some time ago at a Democratic convention said, I didn't leave you, you left me. Mm-hmm. And I think, John Yates is the younger brother of Tucker Yates, who was one of the board members of CBN some years ago, and a dear friend. The whole family are dear friends, and John Yates is in the storm, but I'm sure the people will love him and stand with him. They'll come out of this much stronger, and I don't see the blessing of God descending on that little remnant that took away that building from them. It will be what's called a Pyrrhic victory. They will have won something that nobody wants. But that Anglican church, Falls Church Anglican, now will grow and prosper. They'll be able to have prosperity. The Lord will give them the money they need to buy an appropriate place to worship. And good things will begin to happen to them because they're going to be in unity. The other group, the whole Episcopal Church in America has left its roots. It's just a question of time before the Anglican Communion in the world declares the American Episcopal Church apostate. That's on the way. And so they may have gotten a nice piece of property, but I think they've won the battle and lost the war.
U.S. Catholic bishops are threatening to sue the Obama administration. They're upset over being forced to provide health insurance that includes birth control, even for drugs that may actually cause abortions. The U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops wrote a letter to federal regulators. They said if Congress fails to act quickly, the court is their only recourse. Several small Catholic universities have already filed suit over the policy, citing religious and moral objections. A new blasphemy law in Kuwait is causing concern here in the U.S. Kuwaiti lawmakers approved a measure that could lead to the death penalty in cases of blasphemy against Allah, Muhammad, or the Quran. The U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom calls that law alarming and says it's contrary to international human rights standards. Kuwait is a member of the UN Human Rights Council and has been a strong U.S. ally. The Emir of Kuwait still has to approve that measure. You can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com.